Penguin Audio presents The Striker, an Isaac Bell Adventure by Clive Cussler and Justin Scott. Read by Scott Brick. Prologue. A smoke-filled room. 1912. The Marmon 32 Speedster parked on Wall Street in a shadow between two lampposts. Roundsman O'Reardon took notice. It was the dead of night. Orders said let no one bother the bigwig politicians and office holders who were horse trading upstairs in the Congdon building, and the auto had a clear shot at the limousines waiting for them at the curb. Its side curtains were fogged by the damp rolling off the harbor. O'Reardon had to get close to see inside. The driver was a pleasant surprise, a beautiful lady with straw-blonde hair, and the cop relaxed a little. But all he could see of the gent beside her were steely contours. Still, you couldn't wrap your stick on a Marmon 32 and tell the swells to move along like they were bums on the sidewalk. So with his right hand by his pistol, he tapped the side curtain lightly, like touching his glass to the mahogany to signal the bartender of a classy joint he was ready for another, but didn't mean to be rushing him. A big hand with long, nimble fingers slid the curtain open. O'Reardon glimpsed a snow-white cuff, diamond links, and the black sleeve of a dress coat. The hand seized his in a strong grip. "Paddy O'Reardon, fancy meeting you here." Raked by searching blue eyes, the roundsman recognized the gold mane, the thick flaxen mustache, and the no-nonsense expression that could only belong to Isaac Bell, chief investigator of the Van Dorn Detective Agency. He touched his stick to his helmet.
"Good evening, Mr. Bell. I didn't recognize you in the shadows."
"What are you doing out so late?" Bell asked. O'Reardon started to answer before Bell's grin told him it was a joke. Policemen were supposed to be out late. The detective nodded at the limousines.
"Big doings. Judge Congdon's got a special waiting at Grand Central. Tracks cleared to Chicago.
And I'm sorry to tell you I have me orders to clear the street. Straight from the captain." Bell did not seem to hear. "Paddy, I want you to meet my wife. Marion, may I present Roundsman O'Reardon, former scourge of Staten Island pirates back when he was in the harbor squad. There wasn't a wharf rat in New York who didn't buy drinks for the house the night Paddy came ashore." She reached across her husband with an ungloved hand that seemed to glow like ivory. O'Reardon took it carefully in his enormous fist and bowed low.
"A privilege to meet you, marm. I've known your good husband many years in the line of duty, and may I say, marm, that Mrs. O'Reardon and I have greatly enjoyed your moving picture shows."
She thanked him in a musical voice that would sing in his mind for days. Chief Inspector Bell said, "Well, we better not keep you from your rounds." O'Reardon touched his stick to his helmet again. If a crack private detective chose to canoodle with his own wife in a dark auto on Wall Street in the middle of the night, orders be damned.
"I'll tell the boys not to disturb you."
But Bell motioned him closer and whispered, "I wouldn't mind if they kept an eye out, if I have to leave her alone a moment."
"They'll be drawing straws for the privilege."
Backslapping politicians burst from the building and converged on the smaller of the limousines, a seven-passenger Rambler Knickerbocker. Isaac Bell opened the curtain to hear them.
"Driver, straight to Grand Central."
"Don't love handing the vice presidency to a louse like Congdon, but that's politics."
"Money talks."
The Rambler Knickerbocker drove off. Senior men emerged next. Moving more slowly, they climbed into the second limousine, an enormous Cunningham Model J, hand-built at great expense to Judge James Congdon's own design. To Bell's ear, they sounded less reconciled than resigned.
"Congdon has most of the delegates he needs, and those he doesn't, he'll buy. If only our candidate hadn't died. Always the wrong man."
Isaac Bell waited for the Cunningham to turn the corner. A police motorcycle escort stationed on Broadway clattered after it. If James Congdon captures Vice President, Bell said, the President's life won't be worth a plugged nickel. He kissed Marion's lips. Thank you for making me look harmless to the cops. Are you sure you won't go home? Not this time, she said firmly, and Bell knew there was no dissuading her. This time was different. Although he was dressed for the theater, he left his silk topper on the back seat and donned a broad-brimmed hat with a low crown instead. Marion straightened his tie. Bell said, I've always wondered why you never ask me to be careful. I wouldn't want to slow you down. Bell winked. Not likely. He left his wife with a smile, but as he crossed Wall Street, his expression hardened and the warmth seeped from his eyes. Joseph Van Dorn, the large, bearded founder of the agency, was waiting, deep in shadow and still as ice. He stood watch as Bell picked open the lock on the outside door and followed him in, where Bell picked another lock on a steel door marked Mechanical Room. Inside, it was warm and damp. An orderly maze of thick pipes passed through rows of steam conditioning valves. He compared the control wheels to an engineer's sketch he unfolded from his inside pocket. Isaac Bell climbed back up to the street. He went around to the front of the building. His evening clothes elicited a respectful nod from the doorman. As the politicians said, money talked. Top floor, he told the yawning elevator runner.
I thought they were all done up there.
Not quite. Book 1. Coal. Gleason Mine Number 1, Gleasonburg, West Virginia, 1902. Chapter 1. He was a fresh-faced youth with golden hair, but something about him looked suspicious. A coal cop watching the miners troop down the rails into the mouth of Gleason Mine Number 1 pointed him out to his boss, a Pinkerton detective. The young miner towered over the foreigners the company imported from Italy and Slovenia, and was even taller than the homegrown West Virginia boys. But it was not his height that looked out of place, nor was his whipcord frame unusual. The work was hard, and it cost plenty to ship food to remote coal fields. There was no free lunch in the saloons that lined the muddy main street. A miner clomping along on a wooden peg tripped on a cross tie and stumbled into another miner on crutches. The golden-haired youth glided to steady both, moving so effortlessly he seemed to float. Many were maimed, digging coal. He stood straight on both legs and still possessed all his fingers.
Don't look like no poor worker to me, the coal cop ventured with a contemptuous smirk.
Watching like a cat? Anything that moves, said the Pinkerton, who wore a bowler hat, a six-gun in his coat, and a blackjack strapped to his wrist.
You reckon he's a striker?
He'll wish he ain't.
Gangway!
An electric winch jerked the slack out of a wire between the rails. Miners, laborers, and doorboys jumped aside. The wire dragged a trail of coal cars out of the mine and up a steep slope to the tipple, where the coal was sorted and dumped into river barges that towboats pushed down the Monongahela to Pittsburgh. The tall young miner exchanged greetings with the derailer switch operator. If the wire, which was shackled to a chain bridle on the front car, broke, Jim Higgins was supposed to throw the switch to make the train jump the tracks before the 100-ton runaway plummeted back down into the works.
The cops are watching you, Higgins warned.
I'm no striker.
All we're asking, Higgins answered mildly, is to live like human beings, feed our families, and send our kids to school.
They'll fire you.
They can't fire us all. The coal business is booming and labor is scarce.
Higgins was a brave man. He had to be to ignore the fact that the mine owners would stop at nothing to keep the union out of West Virginia. Men fired for talking up the union, much less calling a strike, saw their wives and children kicked out of the shanties they rented from the Gleason Consolidated Coal and Coke Company.
and when Gleason... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.